The Holy Gospel this morning according to St. John in the first chapter. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. John himself was not the light, but came to testify to the light. And this is the testimony given by John. When the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" he confessed, did not deny it, confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you a prophet? Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." They said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now, these priests and Levites had been sent from the Pharisees. So they asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize you with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." Now, this took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. Gospel of the Lord. Congregation may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. I don't recall where I first heard this, but there's this description of ministry. There's this description of the task of ministers. There's this description about the task of sharing Jesus with others. And by ministers, I'm not talking about ordained stoles on their backs, ministers. And I'm not talking just about rostered leaders in the church. I'm not talking about those licensed to do it professionally. I'm talking about ministers in the larger sense. I'm talking about the ministry of the priesthood of all believers. And that description is that it's our task to draw near to Christ, follow him as closely as possible throughout our lives. And as soon as we've gotten as close as we can to Christ, get the attention of others going in our direction, and then duck out of the way. Draw people towards us as we are near to Christ, and then move so that they might see the Lord, so that they might encounter not us, so that they might be pleased not with us, but with the Lord. I think of that description a bit when it comes to the ministry of John as the forerunner to Jesus. A lot of people found John to be extremely charismatic, exciting. A lot of people were drawn to him. A lot of other people found him upsetting. No one found him easy to ignore. No one found him easy to forget. No one found him to be somebody that just sort of faded into the background. John drew people's attention. He drew people's eyes. He drew people's hearts. And once he had someone's interest, once he had someone's curiosity, this man who ministered in a way that was as subtle as a thunderstorm and bigger than life, once he had their attention, he made himself as small as he possibly could in order that Christ, the one that he was pointing to, might be made great. He drew others in and then cleared the way so that he could direct them not to himself, but to our Lord Jesus. But John was so good at that first part. John was so good at that first part, so good at attracting so much attention. Such a novelty that no matter how much John wished to be the opposite of people's focus, they were insistent anyways. They were insistent to know who John was. So we come to the question at the heart of today's reading. Who are you? They came saying to John. Who is this wild-eyed, tactless, bellicose man from places where mostly outlaws and wild animals lived? And John begins to answer that question, as it is often answered in life, by the process of negation. Who he is not is where John begins. He is not the Messiah. He is not the one who has come to bring salvation to the people. He is not come to be the source of goodness and life and truth and peace. And John is not Elijah. John is not a return of the great prophet who was carried off into heaven, or another of the line of earlier prophets. Now, this second part, he may have needed to do a bit more convincing, because so much about John, so much about his conviction, so much about his boldness, so much about his single-minded commitment to his message and his submission to the will of God was definitely reminiscent of some of the earlier prophets. But he didn't come to live as any of those prophets did. He didn't come to be the uniter of a nation. He didn't come to announce political renewal. He didn't come to announce political rebirth or military victory, as they often did. He didn't come to announce that God's favor and presence were going away, were being taken from them. In fact, absolutely the opposite. And he didn't come to establish a lineage of prophets. He didn't come to establish a school of thinking, a genre of prophetic thought and teaching that would be passed on through the centuries, as with other prophets and their theologies. He was a one-and-done voice with a one-and-done mission. He was a blip of shelf life compared to Jeremiah or Isaiah, Ezekiel, Elijah, Moses. And after making known through negation all that he wasn't, John finally proclaims who he is. And as I shared with Havana during the children's message, what he shares with people is, don't worry about my name. Don't worry about my lineage. Don't worry about my credentials. Know this, I am here to announce the light coming into the world, period. When I was in seminary, I think I've shared this story before. When I was in seminary, Dr. Anderson used to call us into his office at some point in our tenure at the school and ask us what we wanted on our tombstone. The question was intended to basically challenge us to confess what is at the heart of our Christian identity. What, if we had to sum it up as succinctly as possible, do we want known about our life? And for John, that was very simple. come to testify to the light. The rest of it, my job, my years, everything else about the dash, as we talk about it at times, everything else about my dash is unimportant, doesn't matter. He came to testify to the light. He came to direct others to Jesus. He came to live out that description that I shared from the jump, urgently, loudly, calling for others to look his way so that he could in turn humble himself, get out of the way so that they would instead see Jesus. And we see it immediately. We see it immediately. If you continue the very next paragraph, the very next paragraph after today's gospel, it says, the next day we're told, John was with his followers and his students are gazing at their master, hanging on every word. And John says, no, there, look over there. It's the Lamb of God. Look, Christ, look there. And then a handful of verses later, he does it again when he sees Jesus going by. He testifies to the light by pointing to God's activity and presence. And likewise, we can testify by making others to know. By making others to know when they're struck by unexpected kindness, when they're struck by mercy, when they're struck by forgiveness or beauty or healing. We can say, this is the Christ of God. Give thanks to the Lord. And he prepares through a baptism of repentance. Why do you do that? Says the religious leaders. If you're not Elijah, if you're not one of the prophets of old, why are you doing this? John offers this because washing us from our sins allows us to turn, allows us to be a different way, allows us to see the Messiah. Because repentance, and he does this because repentance isn't just apologizing. Repentance is turning our entire orientation. Repentance is taking on new hearts. Repentance is taking on an entire view of existence that is oriented towards God. One of my favorite of so many beautiful moments from the series The Chosen is from one of the early episodes. It depicts Mary of Magdala talking with Nicodemus. Nicodemus had recently come to Mary of Magdala when she was possessed by demons and evil spirits, forcing her, driving her into a life of brokenness and sin. And he had tried to rid her of these things. He had tried to drive these things out from her and had zero success. But then a short time later, he sees her. He sees her and she's in her right mind. And she is full of beauty and grace. And she is full of faith, living a life dedicated to serving others and serving God. And he's confounded by this. And he says, how? Why did this happen? How did this happen? Who are you? And she simply says, I was one way, and now I am another. This is repentance. This is what John's baptism is giving to those who come to him. And for us, as followers of Christ, we're not just some brighter, shinier version of what we would otherwise be. As followers of Christ, we're composed of something different. I mean, on a DNA level, everything might be what it would otherwise be, but we're not the same people. We're not the same people. We're something different altogether through the purpose that we have in God. And like John the Baptizer, we're called to testify to that light. Popular message throughout centuries of the church, a message that, well, some pulpits have it engraved somewhere. Not this one, but a lot of pulpits do. Some have it on a little plaque. Some have it otherwise affixed somewhere in it or around it. It's a statement from the 12th chapter of John. We're told in the 12th chapter of John that there are a number of Greek thinkers who come to Thomas with a simple request. Sir, we would see Jesus. Sir, we would see Jesus. And as I said, this is affixed and featured in a lot of pulpits to remind those who enter those pulpits that whatever we might extrapolate, whatever truths we might give, whatever insights we might have to offer, whatever great jokes we might tell from this setting, that we are here that people might see Jesus, that our lives are here that people might see Jesus. Your lives, that people might see Jesus. Do people ever note your generosity? I'll bet they do. Explain to them that it's not about your generosity alone, it's also about the light that you bear. Do people admire your resiliency and your patience? Sure they do. Share with them that it's not of your own making, but of the one whose life you seek to share. Do people appreciate your creativity, your hopefulness, your encouragement? Absolutely they do. I know they do. Share with them it's not only you that they can thank, but the one who works in and through and with you. John got people's attention so he could point them to something more. May we do the same. Amen.